Hello friends, welcome to another video on semantic segmentation. In this video, we will learn to segment human images using the DeepLab version 3 architecture, which is enhanced with a channel-wise attention mechanism. This video will cover the entire segmentation process starting from the data processing till evaluation of the model. To learn more about it, make sure that you watch the complete video and subscribe the channel. To support the channel, check out the membership. By taking the membership, you are not only helping for my research, but in return, you will get more content. So, without any further delay, let's start the video. Here we are in our Atom Text Editor. And before we start with the data processing part, we'll first take a look at the dataset itself. Okay. So, this is the dataset for people's segmentation. It contains three folders. First, the images. So, here you can take a look at the some of the images used for the training of this model, and we are going to split this data into 90 by 10 split. So we will use 90% of the data for training and rest 10% we'll use for testing, or you can say the validation. And the next is the mask folder. So it contains mask. Basically it's a grayscale image which contains pixel in the range of 0 and 1. 0 basically means background, and one means the white region, that is foreground region, which is important to us. And third, segmentation folder basically contains the splits. I'm not going to follow these splits. I'm going to split the data set myself. It's up to you how you want to split this data set. Now we'll first start with the data processing part. Here we will load the data, then we are going to split it, and then we will apply the data augmentation on the training part and leave the validation as it is. Okay. So now we need to import some of the libraries. First is the operating system library. Second is NumPy, because we always need array matrix and a lot of things. So for that we need NumPy. And here we are dealing with images and masks. So we need OpenCV to read them, write them, resize them, and a whole lot of tasks. Next is the Glob library. The Glob is used to extract the paths. Okay. So from these images and mask folder, which are inside this data set, we have to extract whole lot of images. Okay. So for to extract all the path of all these images and mask, you will use the Glob library. Next is the TQDM. The TQDM is basically for the progress bar, which is going to display on the console, because like we are reading 10,000 images and it's looping over 10,000, it would take like 10 minutes, but we would not see any progress. So for that we would use a progress bar to see how much images are done and how much images are left. For that we're going to use the TQDM. Okay. Now let's create a function called create dir. This function used to create a path if that path does not exist, because I don't want that the user or you people have to create the folder manually and then work. Otherwise, it would give you an error. So we automate the process of creating directories also. And here we're going to use OS module for that. Okay, I'm sorry. It should be os.path.exist. Here we check if that path does not exist, then create that path. Okay, so this is the folder, not the folder, the function. So creating a directory, this is basically a simple comment over the function. So I also want you to just please make a habit of creating proper comments. Okay, spelling mistake is there. EATING, creating a directory. Okay. Now let's go to the main function. So this is our main function. Let's follow the seeding mechanism first. We'll seed the environment, the randomness which is present within the NumPy, and we'll seed it so that we have the same randomness every time. Okay, here we'll load the data set. Okay, so first is the path. You can say data path equals to person segmentation. We'll rename it and we'll copy this. So this is the path for the data set. Now we'll create a function called load data. Okay, load data. We're gonna give it the data path. Okay, so this function is we would create. It take the data path and it would return the training and the testing splits. Okay, the images and mask or all of that it would return. So let's start working on this function first. Load data and you have to take the path and here we write a argument called split whose value is 0.1. Its default value is 0.1. You can change this accordingly. So this 0.1 basically means that out of the complete data we're going to use 1% of the data for testing or validation purpose. Okay, here the validation and testing split is basically the same, and for further checking we're going to take images from the internet and check on them. Okay, so don't worry about that, we'll do a complete testing on it. So first of all we'll load the images. Okay, so we'll refer images with the variable x. So here we're going to use the globe variable. Okay, so first is the path. If we go inside this folder, the people segmentation folder, we would have images and then mask. So we would write images here, and here we have .jpg images. So we're going to say star .jpg. Load all the paths with the ending of jpg, where ending is jpg. Star basically means anything. So it's basically a pattern here. We specify pattern, anything which ends with .jpg. Okay, and same we're going to do for loading the mask. For mask, we're going to use the capital Y. And here instead of images we're going to write mask, and instead of jpg we're going to use png. I already know their extension, you can check it out if your data set is different or any other thing is there. Okay, now we'll see how the x and y look. So we'll loop over them. Basically they are list. Okay, so the length of x and y should be same, so we're going to loop over them in zip. You say x comma y. So first of all you're going to print this path and I'm going to break it here. Okay, so you can see this is the path for the image and this is the path for the mask. But if you note one thing here, the names are different. Like for its segmentation data set, the image need to have its respective annotation. Okay, like let's do one thing here, let's just save and these two things, read and save them here, and I will show you what I mean. So you're going to say x equals to cv2.imread x. Okay, and we're going to save it. Okay, so here we have read the image and saving it. Same we're going to do for the mask. This simple code, just don't see the variable name and everything. This is just basically a rough code to just show you what is happening here. Okay, so everything is done. Okay, now this is x and this is okay. Change it something here, so we will multiply it with 255 because y basically contain only two values, that is 0 and 1, and we would multiply it with 255. So 0 remains 0 and 1 became 255, and 255 basically refers to the white color. So this is the input image and this is the mask, and you can see the image and image and its respective annotation are not the same image, they are different. So that's what happening here. So what we need to do, we need to arrange them in a sequence, and for that we're going to use a simple function. Got it. That's why I have just saved these images and show you how they look, so that you get an idea how data processing is done. Maybe you left this mistake and haven't checked it, and you see why my model is not performing well. So this is because there's an error. Okay, the sequence of the images and mask path are not the same, and here if you see the name are the same. Okay, you can see the name are the same, their extension differ, and that's not an issue. Now if you see the image and the mask, you can see they are the same. Okay, so now we have sorted the list. into a proper sequence. Now we want to split this, okay, into training and testing. So split size is a variable which would contain the 1% of the x. So we're going to say integer length of x into split. So this is split size. So now we're going to use the sklearn train test split. So for that we're going to load it from sklearn. Okay, so we have loaded this train test split here. Let me comment it out. Loading the images and mask. Okay, now here we split it. Splitting the data into training and testing. Okay, so this is a kind of proper commenting. You should follow this. So first we're going to split the image. So we're going to say train x and test x. Now we will provide the capital X, basically list of all the images, and test size is split size. Next is random state, and this that to be 42. So like this, we're gonna split the mask, and here instead of x we're gonna write y, y refer to mask, and instead of the capital X we're gonna have capital Y here. So here with these two lines you have splitted the images into training and testing, and same for the mask, we have split the mask into training and testing. So make sure that your random state remains the same. Like if you have provide 42 here and 82 here, so it would not be same because it's split in a same, it's split the on the same sequence if you provide a same random state. Okay, so make sure that these two variables random state in both these lines remains the same. Okay, now we're going to return this training and testing set. Okay, so we have written it, and now we're going to go here. Okay, we will remove this return line from here, and now we'll check the length, basically the length of the training and testing. Let's run it here. Okay, so you can see for training we have 5111 images, and for testing we have 567 images. So it's a fair amount. You can even do it 20%, but for this list let's debate. Let's go for 90% and 10% split. Okay, 90-10 split. Now we'll use data augmentation on it, and as we're going to use data augmentation, we need to create some new directories to save the training and the testing images. On training we would apply data augmentation, and on testing we won't apply. So we are creating new directories to save augmented data, and the name of the directories is new data train, and within train directory we have two more directories, image and mask, and same for the testing. We would create a test and the directory inside the new data, and which also contain image and mask directory. Okay, so this is done. Now we have created the directory. Now another function for data augmentation. Okay, so we create a function called argument data, and first it would take the images either for the training or testing, then it would take the mask. Okay, then it would take the path. Okay, like new data slash train here, where these images need to be saved, and last is a variable, a boolean variable called argument. If it is set to true, this means that apply data augmentation. If it is set to false, don't apply data augmentation. Okay, so we're going to create this. Okay, let it so let us start working on this function here. Okay, so we're going to def argument data. Okay, so argument data first is images, mask, save path, and a argument variable, which is by default set to true. And if you don't want to apply data augmentation, set it to false. Inside it, we will set two variables, height and width. We'll fix them, okay? As we are working with images, so we need fixed size of data. We cannot, like, for one image you use 512 by 512, for another you use 100 by 100, for third you use 1000 by 1000. So you cannot do that. You have to have fixed size data set, like in batches specifically. Like for one batch you can have one size, for another batch you can have another batch size. But for this experiment, we're gonna fix the size of all the images to 512 by 512. And from my point of view, this size is really good. It is not that high and not that low. Like for some people it may be high, because they would like say, how are you gonna train these such large images? And don't worry about that. I have only trained this model. Like for this video, I'm going to show you how the training would begin, but I won't like train it for 20 or 25 epochs. I've trained it on like some good amount of epochs so that we get good performance. Okay, so now we have specified our height and width. Now we will loop over the images, okay, for x and y and zip images and mask. And here we're going to use the TQDM, if you remember the progress bar which I have showed you, tell you about in this beginning. It has one variable called total, which basically wants the value of the loop, how much time the loop would run. Okay, now we're gonna, oh, you already know how the x and y will look like, but still I will show you x and y, and we're gonna write a break here. Okay, so you can see we have the size and then we have the path. So for now, we are going to extract this name from here, this name specifically, because we need to save the images, and for saving images we need a name. And now if I go to the our project directory, you can see new data folder, and within that we have two folder, test and train, and within train we have two subfolder, images and mask. And for now these are blank. And for same for the test, images and mask directory. Now these are the directories where we will save our data. Okay. Now let's do one thing. Let's extract this name. Okay, you can see this is a complete path, and it is basically a string, and we can split it on the base of the slash. Okay, and it would give us a list. So let's do that. You know, call name here. You want to say x dot split. Okay. You write slash. So we're gonna call print name. Okay, so you can see a list which contain people's segmentation, images, and the name with the extension. So we need this last element, last item from this list. So we're gonna say -1. -1 refer to the last element. Now look at this, we have the complete name with extension. Now we need this name, so we can again split this string on the basis of this dot. Again it would create a list. Okay, now within this list we first have the name and then the extension. We need the name, which is on the index 0. We're gonna say 0. So now you can see we have the name. Okay, so successfully we have extracted the name. Like this you can extract the extension, but for this for now I don't want to extract the extension. Name is enough for me. Now we are going to read the image and mask. Now say x equal to cv2.imread x. We're going to read it as an RGB image. Next is y. Again, we are going to read mask also as an RGB image for now. It's not an issue because it is for data augmentation, not for training. Okay, now we need to load the library which you're going to use for the augmentation. So here for the augmentation I'm going to use this augmentation library, which work really well, and I generally use this even for my research papers. Okay, it provide a whole lot of functions like horizontal flip, grid distortion, everything, channel shuffle, and a whole lot of thing to work with. Okay, so we have loaded the library. Now, if you remember, we have this variable augment true or false. First of all, here we start the data augmentation part. If argument equals to true, what happened? Something would surely happen. But if this is false, what would happen? We will first work upon if augmentation is false. Okay, so what we're gonna do, we're gonna have a capital X list and capital Y as list. So what we're gonna do, if we don't apply augmentation, we would only resize the original image and save them. Okay, something would surely happen here if you apply data augmentation, and we would increase this list with more images. Okay, with more array of images. Now we will loop over this X and Y. Okay, this capital X and capital Y list. We're gonna say for I comma M, I refer to image and M refer to mask in zip X comma Y. Okay, so now if you see the there we have images, and if you see they are not of same size. Some are landscape, some are in landscape format like this. This is a landscape format, and this image is in portrait format. So their size is entirely different. So if we like resize them in a fixed format, they would be like uneven stretching and squeezing problem. Let me just show you some of the examples of this of uneven stretching and squeezing, which is really an issue. I generally don't like those images. Let's do one thing, we would resize them. We'll say I here, and then we'll specify the size. Same for the mask, to be resize M width comma height. Okay, now we need path to save them. Okay, so if okay, so we need some temporary name, tmp image name. Okay, so if you remember, we have extracted the name, and we're gonna say .png. We're gonna use the same extension for both image and mask as png, temporary mask name. This is good. Now image path, now we need to save the images in a proper path. So we have save path, then inside save path we have image folder to save the image, then we have temporary image name, then we have our mask path, and instead of image you say mask here. Okay, now we will save these images. First we can say image path and I here, then mask path and M here. So here we would loop over these X and Y list, we would resize them, we would give a proper path, and then save them. And this is all done for the training. Okay, there's some issue. Okay, I remember, we have set augmentation to true and we have to set it false. Okay, you can see it has run only for one. If you go to this, okay, if you go to this new data, then train, and then image. Okay, now you look at this image, you can clearly see this uneven compressing. The image is compressed unevenly. Okay, we can even find the original image within this people segmentation if we have the name. And if I remember the name, like if you I can see the name 803. Okay, this multiple 803. You can say 667803. So this is the original image here. If you see this and see that image, you can see how much uneven compressing has been done on this original image to resize it to this image. So what I'm going to try to solve this problem with some way. Okay, let's see what that way is. I'm going to keep this image aside on my second screen and we'll later look at it. Now what I'm going to do, instead of resizing, what my plan is to do a center cropping. Okay, I feel center cropping would be much better option. Okay, like for some images center cropping would be perfect, but some images would be so small that center cropping cannot be used on them. So let's do try statement, and here we will use center cropping. It's also a data augmentation technique. So we're gonna say, okay, I'm gonna say AUG is equals to center crop, and here we have specified the height and width, which we have specified as 512 by 512. Next we are going to extract these augmented images and mask, the center crop image and mask. Okay, this is in case of try statement, if it is done properly. Now in case we encounter an error, how we gonna do? We are going to again use the resizing. Now we will run this part of code and we'll see what happened to the image. Okay, we have run this. Yes, now we will see, we're going to train and we'll see the image. Okay, let me just reload it. My system is little slow. Okay, now I can see the same image, some part is cut from this image, but there's no uneven compression squeeze problem. If you see this original image and the center crop part, I feel the center crop part is much better. Okay, much better approach is there, because now information is not unevenly compressed and squeezed. I always feel like try to preserve the original information, which now we're going to use for the rest of the part and we'll see what happened. Okay, so this is done. Now how are we going to save the image? Now the main issue here is that how do we apply data augmentation here? Okay, what happened to those images when we apply data augmentation? How are we going to save them? So here above you can see we have already imported some function, horizontal flip, grid distortion, some things like that. And one example you have seen here how the data augmentation works with this with those functions. We can say aug is equals to horizontal flip. Okay, like this. So this is horizontal flip, where p refer to the probability, how much probability you is there that you want to apply this function. So we want to apply this. There's no random chances. I want to apply it, I will not apply it, I surely want to apply it. That's why I have said p equals to 1.0 or 1.0. now we would give it as in input. So in this line augmented, we give it as an input, image equals to x and marks equal to y. So you can see we have already read this images and we have images and mask array, and here x1 and y1, we've extracted the augmented images. So x1 and y1 are augmented images and mask. Okay, so like this we have applied an augmentation here, which is horizontal flip. Now what we're gonna do here, we're gonna append the list with x1 and y1. Okay, y1 should be in the while list. Okay, so now in this and the data augmentation function, we're gonna say data augmentation to true. Now let's do one thing, let me delete this folder and it would be created automatically because this function folder does not exist. Okay, so we are doing this data augmentation only for one image now, so that we can see what its effect on one image, and same effect we can apply on the old image. Okay, so you can see there's some issue here, only one image is saved, and I just know why it is, because if you remember here in this loop we have to give a name, and for every image, like it's giving an image and mask, and for every image and mask we are using the same name. That's why it's replacing over time. So what we will do here, we will use a variable called index, Okay, so we have set index here, and that's what we're going to use here. We're going to say index. So this is going to solve our problem of overwriting again and again. And at last, we're going to increment. And if you don't increment it again, you will face the same issue. You would again have same name. Okay, now I can see. Let me delete this. Let us delete this complete folder again, because same issue would arise in the mask folder also. Okay. Now it's done. You will see the images. You can see this image and it's horizontal flip. So it's basically the same. Now there's also one case we can apply vertical flipping, but I won't apply vertical flipping here because it's rare case that you see an image of human inverted. Maybe you see, you can apply it, you can use an inverted image, you can test, but I won't use inverted data augmentation like vertical flipping here because it's a rare case that you would see an inverted human image. You can see some rotated image of human, but vertical flipping is not like we would see generally. Next, we can turn the image to a grayscale format, which is really easy, which we can do using the OpenCV. So now we have two images. Okay, it should not be here. I'm in the wrong place. It should be here. So now first is the horizontal flipping, vertical flipping we are not applying. Second is grayscale, because you can encounter some images as grayscale also. So let's run it again. We'll see how the grayscale image looks. Again, this issue, this is original, this is horizontal flipping, and this is grayscale. So we have applied grayscale on the original image. Now we'll include some more data augmentation here. I'll just copy them straightforwardly here. So first is the channel shuffling. So we're going to shuffle the RGB channels. If you remember, we have read images RGB and there are three channels, red, green and blue. So we can shuffle them and create some new image. So the color scheme of the image would be changed. Second is post dropout. So what we're going to do, we're going to introduce some holes, okay, in the image. So these holes are basically replacing some information of the image with the 000, that is black. So that portion would become black. So we just want to enforce the model to learn even from incomplete data. Okay, and the last is rotating the image. So we're going to rotate the image to 45 degrees to the left and right. So from one single image, we have created 5 more images. Okay, so let's run it now. Okay, so you can see 6 images here. First is original, this is horizontal flipping, then grayscaling, then channel shuffling. So if you can see how the channel how the color scheme changes. Okay, I'll just show you one example. So this image in the left is the original image, and the image in the right is basically channel shuffled. So you can see color scheme changes, the sweater changes from red to green, if you can see. Okay, so this is basically creating a new data from existing data. So through this, we just enforce the model to generalize well. This is coarse dropout. You can see 3 black squares introduced in it. So basically we are removing information from this part, so it will enforce the model to learn from it. And this is rotation, so we have rotated it to 45 degrees, right? Okay, so from one image, 5 more image we have created. Now what we can do, we can remove this break line from here and run this for more than one image. Okay, so it's running very fast. Let me show you some more examples. Okay, let's start with this. So you can see images, what you will one you will feel here, the images are not stretch or squeeze, they are properly cut, and all images should have human. So that's why I've used center cropping instead of random cropping or cropping from the beginning. I tried center cropping. So you can see this is basically color, not the color, the channel of link. See some more examples. Okay, so now we'll apply data augmentation to both. So there are also some cases like this where some part of the human is cut, but that's not an issue. We are also, so in this case the model would also learn that if a face doesn't appear, doesn't mean that human isn't it there. The rest part is also considered as human. So this is also reinforced in the model. Here you can see in this image only face is there, so model should learn that the face is also a part of human body. It should not be that if face and body is there together, then only it would segment. So we have to reinforce the model to learn good representation. So that's why we use data heavy data augmentation sometime. And data augmentation is also generally used because annotating images and then creating more data, okay, is costly and it's time consuming. So it's better to create more data from the existing data. So for the test data set, we won't apply data augmentation. Okay, so let me run this part, and it would take some time to run because there are 5000 images and 500, nearly 567, okay, yeah, 567 images. The testing also, it would take time. So this is all about the data processing. Now this new data folder would be created containing training and the testing images. So we are not going to refer to this original part. Now we will, for the rest of the video, we will use this new data, that is augmented data. So this is all about the data processing part. Here we will start building the DeepLab version 3 plus architecture for the human image segmentation. In this DeepLab version 3 architecture, we are going to use ResNet 50 as the pre-trained encoder. So first of all, let's take a look at the diagram of the architecture. So here you can see a simple figure of the DeepLab version 3. Here they have input image which is passed through the ResNet 101. The output of this ResNet 101 passes through these blocks. So these blocks completely refer to as ESPP, that is atrospatial pyramid pooling. After that, it is followed by one by one convolution to reduce the number of parameters. Then it is followed by an upsampling by 4, and then it is concatenated with a low level feature from the encoder, that is pre-trained encoder. Then followed by 3x3 convolution and again upsampling by 4. Then we get the prediction. Okay, so this is a simple model for the DeepLab version 3. So we'll follow something like this and start building the DeepLab version 3. So here you can see we have imported all the required layer and everything. Here we also imported the ResNet 50 architecture. So now let's start building it. So we'll first start with a function called DeepLab version 3 plus. It takes the shape as the input. First of all, we define the input for the model, for the layers. We're going to say inputs equals to input and then shape. Okay, next we will import the ResNet 50 encoder. We're going to say encoder in the comments, and encoder equals to ResNet 50 weights equals to ImageNet. Then include top is set to false. Include top basically means that whether you want to add a classifier at the bottom of the network. We don't want to include any classifier network here. We'll use this encoder for the segmentation task, so no classification is done here. That's why include top is set to false. Next is the input tensor. An input tensor is said to be inputs, the variable which you have defined here. This act as an input for the entire network. So this is first passes through the ResNet 50. Okay, so this is kind of sequence. First, in this input is passes to the ResNet 50 encoder. Now we'll take the output of the image or the image features from this encoder. So we're going to say image features is equals to encoder dot get layer, and here we will provide the name of the layer. The name of the layer I have already written it down here, that is con4 underscore block 6 underscore out, and we're going to take its output. Okay, so now this image feature act as the output for this entire ResNet 50 architecture. Okay, so you can see the sequence. First input image passes to this network. This network gives this image feature as the output. Now we'll apply ASPP upon these image features. So we're going to say ASPP give image features as the input. Let's define ASPP here and give inputs. Okay, so this is ASPP. Okay, let's do one thing first. We'll call this dplyr version 3 within this main function. Dplyr version 3 plus and shape is 512 by 512 by 3. Okay, so we have this input. Let's print the shape of this input first. Okay, let's print the shape and see. You can see it's a shape of 32 by 32 by 1024. Okay, so 32 by 32 basically height and width, and 1024 is the number of output channels. Okay, so now we are in the ASPP. We'll start building this atrospatial pyramid polling. So ASPP is basically a bridge between the encoder and the decoder part of this ASPP. Not the ASPP, the dplyr version 3 architecture. So let's start building it. So let's say y1 equals to average pooling. We'll start with the average pooling option. So what we'll do here, we'll average pool over the entire feature map, that is this input. Okay, and the pooling size will be okay, so we need the shape here, the input shape, inputs dot shape. So we're gonna say shape, we'll copy this and say shape 1 and shape 2. So shape 1 and shape 2 basically refer to 32 by 32. So we have a pool size of 32 by 32 and average pooling is done here. Okay, so now this feature map would be converted into a size of 1 by 1 by 1024. Okay, give the inputs as the input. Okay, so it has converted into 1 by 1. Let me print it and show you. So this is the original size and I will see the converted size, that is 1 by 1. Now we'll use some convolution layer here and upsample it. Then so we're gonna say y1 equals to conv2d 256 as the number of features, kernel size as 1. Okay, padding equals to same. We don't want to mess with the size, okay, the height and width of the feature map. So we're gonna say every time padding equals to same, then use bytes equals to false. Okay, so this is done. Now we're gonna give input as the y1. Next it is followed by the best normalization. Input y1, after best normalization followed by the activation. Inside it we will provide the ReLU. Okay, so this is done. Now still the shape is 1 by 1. Now I'll upsample it. So we're gonna say upsampling 2d, and how much we want to upsample is depend upon this shape. The same shape using pooling, we're gonna use it here. Now interpolation would be bilinear, so we're gonna say comma interpolation is equals to bilinear, and input would be y1. Now we're going to print its shape, y1.shape. You can see it is converted back into 32 by 32, but the number of output channels changed from 1024 to 256, which is basically specified here. So y1 is done. So it is basically average pooling or image pooling. Okay, this image pooling is done. Now it is followed by 1 by 1 convolution. We will directly copy this information, this y1 from here, and we'll change its name from y1 to y2. And here let's say inputs, the main input, the image feature as the input for this this convolution layer, that is one by one convolution layer. Input for the Bayes normalization and ReLU would also be changed. So now this one by one convolution layer is also done. That is followed by the three convolution layer, where the dilation rate would be applied, and the dilation rate is 6, 12 and 18 sequentially. Okay. So again, we're going to copy the code. I won't write it again. So, but you can also do the same thing, or you can write it yourself. You want to practice more. Here the kernel size is 3. Here we need to apply the dilation rate. So we say dilation rate equals to 6, and the input for the Bayes normalization would be changed to Y3, and same for the ReLU. Again, we're going to copy this code. Here the dilation rate would change from 6 to 12. We're going to change the name to Y3 to Y4. Again, Y4 and Y4. So this is done. Next, with the rate 18. Okay. So this time, rate 18, change the name from Y4 to Y5. Dilation would be changed from 12 to 18. And then the input of the Bayes normalization change from Y4 to Y5. So this whole process basically for these is repeated. Just there's a change in the dilation rate. Okay. Now we'll concatenate all these features. So we're going to say Y equals to concatenate Y1, Y2, Y3, Y4 and Y5. Okay. Now it is followed by again a one by one convolution. So I'm going to copy it from here. These layers are basically repeated. Okay. So input would be Y. That is the concatenated feature map. Okay, so this is the ASPP block. Let's return this Y. ASPP is complete. So here you can see we have different thing. First is followed by the image pooling. Okay, so there is upsampling. So it basically learns. This convolution layer learns basically upsampling information here. And this basically main thing is the dilation here. So this dilation basically increase the receptive field of the convolution layer. So it sees the things from a broader view. So I'll say ASPP. Okay. So the output would be, let's say XA equals to ASPP. I'll print the shape of XPP. Because we need to upsample it now. And we want to see the shape before upsampling. Okay, so you can see a shape of 32 by 32 by 256. Now we'll upsample it 4 times. If you remember, in upsampling by 4 times, and interpolation is equals to bilinear. So it's a bilinear upsampling. Let's check its shape. You can see it is converted from 32 to 128 by 128. So this feature map is upsampled 4 times using the bilinear interpolation. Next, we're going to extract the low level features from the encoder. We're going to say x underscore b. So this time the name of the layer is Cone 2 block 2 out. Now it is followed by some convolution layer here. I'm going to directly copy the code here. Okay, you can see the convolution layer are these. So these are the convolution layers followed by. Now it is followed by concatenation. So we're going to concatenate these X A features and XB features. Okay. Now I'm gonna print the shape and check, because from time to time you should check the shape and run the model. You can see if there's any error or anything. You can see the shape, height or width of the filter are still 128 by 128, but the number of output channels became 304. Okay, that's okay. That's not an issue. Now it is followed by some more convolution layers. I'll copy this from here and I'm gonna say X. I'm gonna change its name to X, not XB. Okay, so filters here would be 256 and the kernel size is 3. Okay, the padding would remain the same and use bytes would remain the same. Then input for the base normalization and the relu would also be changed to X. Okay, so till now everything is clear. Let's print the shape again. So basically printing shape, I mean, let's run it again and see. Okay, so till now everything is fine, no issues. Again, let's follow some same layers. Again, it's 3x3 convolution followed by base normalization and a relu with same number of filters, that is 256. Now it is followed by a upsampling, that is 4x4 bilinear interpolation. Input is X. Okay, now it is upsampled. Now at last it is followed by a convolution layer, basically a 1x1 convolution layer. Not relu. The last activation function would be sigmoid, because here we are doing binary segmentation. The number of channel would be 1. So let's print the shape of this X. Okay, you can see the shape is 512x512x1, and this is the output shape of our feature, not the feature map, that is mask, the predicted mask. Now you can build the model. So we're gonna say model equals to model class. First is the inputs, then X as the output. We're gonna return this model. Okay. We can say model this and then model dot summary. Now we'll print the summary of this model and see that if there's any error. Okay, so you can see the summary of the entire model and it's working correctly. It starts with the shape of 512x512x3 and it goes through the entire encoder and the decoder part and it returns the 512. Okay, I think there's some issue or error here because the number of parameters are like really less. Okay, let me just check it and I'll get back to you. So I found the error is this: the input for this convolution layer is incorrect. It should be X instead of XB. Okay, and here also it should be X instead of XB. That's the issue, because we have concatenated XA and XB features here and the output is in the X variable, so we need to provide the X variable. So do check this out, whether you made the same mistake or not when you are literally copying everything. So these mistakes are common. So now we'll run this and check it. Okay, now it's okay. We can see the number of huge number of parameter. So we can clearly assume this is literally the correct architecture. You can see the concatenated features here. The entire summary of the architecture is there. So this is the correct. So this entire architecture is basically the deep lab. Okay, deep lab with ResNet 50 as a pre-trained architecture. Now one thing I want to introduce here is a channel wise attention mechanism. So I'm going to add squeeze and excitation here. So if you don't know, squeeze and excitation is basically a channel wise attention mechanism. So what I feel problem with the convolution is that, let's say this convolution layer outputs 256 channel. So what it treats every channel as same. So every channel is not equally important. So that's why we'll use squeeze and excitation block, which is a channel wise attention mechanism. So it applies attention to each channel and scale each channel respectively how much important it is. Okay. So we'll write a function called squeeze and excitation. So squeeze and excite, it take the inputs and a ratio to compress the features as 8. So we're gonna say init is equals to inputs. You know, copy this input information, then number of filters we need to count. We need number of filters. If minus one, so all the number of features or the filters are on the last axis. If you see the last axis, that's why minus one for the last axis. Shape of this quiz and excitation would be one by one by filters. Okay, let's start with. So it start with the global average polling. So we'll get the global features of all the channels. Okay. So we use a global average polling. So we get an embedding, a global embedding for each channel respectively. Then we reshape it. So here we use the SE shape. Input is SE. Okay. Next comes the dense connections. Okay. So here's a dense connection, filters divided by the ratio. So here we compress, basically squeeze the features, relu activation, kernel initializer, and use by set. Next is again a dense layer, but with the change in the number of filters. Okay, here the number of filters are same as the input, and activation is changed to sigmoid. Sigmoid basically outputs a value between 0 and 1. So 0, it acts as an importance or a scale for the features. A number near to 0 means that it is less important. A number closer to 1 means it is really much important. So that's how it works. If you multiply any value with 0, it became 0. If you multiply anything with 1, it remains same. So what it does, the feature which are importance remains the same, but the features which are not important decreases slightly depending upon the value. Okay. Next, we'll multiply the original input with the attention. Init into SE. Okay. And we will return the X. So this is the squeeze and excite block. And I'll introduce it in some places which I literally feel like I should introduce. First is the concatenation of the XA and XB, if you remember here. Here, because there is a concatenation of two different features, okay, from two different layers. First is the image feature, second is the low level feature, okay, and one is before this upsampling. So these are the places I feel like I should use these channel wise attention mechanism. If you feel like you should use it in much more places or after every activation function, it's up to you. It's not an issue. It's up to your requirement where you want to use it. Now we'll run it again and see if there's any issue or any problem. You can see total number of parameters still aren't much affected because it's literally very lightweight in nature. This squeeze and excitation does not add much of the parameter, but it's improved the performance. So that's why I add channel wise attention mechanism in this deep lab architecture to further improve the performance of this model. So now the model is complete. If you have any question about it, then comment below, or have any problem, or I have done any mistake, please comment it below. Now we will start working on the training part of the deep lab version 3+ architecture. Here we will train the model on the human image segmentation data set. So let's start the code. So first of all, we are going to import the required libraries. First, we'll write this message so that we can get rid of the unknown TensorFlow messages. We just want to see this clear terminal. Next, we'll import some of the libraries, okay, and the functions which we require. So here are all the libraries and functions which we require. Some of them include like TensorFlow callbacks, then optimizer. Here we use Adam optimizer, then a two matrices, that is recall and precision. Next, we have imported the deep lab plus architecture. See the name, I think it's correct. Yeah, the name is correct. Then from the matrix file, we have imported all the three functions. First is IOU. IOU is basically intersection over units and matrix, which is commonly used in most of the segmentation tasks. So here we are also using it. Next is the dice coefficient. It is much similar to IOU. It is also used to calculate the performance of a segmentation task. And next is the dice loss. Dice loss is basically 1 minus dice coefficient. So So here we will use dice loss as the main loss function instead of the binary loss entropy, which is normally used. Now we'll quickly create some global hyperparameters. Here we'll define height and width, because these two height and width will be used at multiple places. So we would define them at the top level. Next, we will copy some functions from this data file. First, this created directory function. We can also import it from the data file, or we can simply paste it. Okay. So here we have created a function create dir, which is used to create a directory. Because while training, we need to save some data, some files. So that's why we need to create. We will create a directory and we will save the data there. Okay. Next, we would create a function called shuffling, which would shuffle the data. Next, we would create a function called shuffling. So this function take the images and masks and shuffle them. Okay. Now let's move to the main function and start writing some codes. Okay. So first of all, we are going to seed the environment. You know, seed the environment. First, the numpy. As always, 42. Then we are going to seed the TensorFlow randomness. Okay, it's random set seed. Again, 42. Okay. Now we are going to create a directory. We're going to say create dir, and we're going to say files. Next would be some hyperparameters. So first of all is the batch size. I'm going to say, okay, it should not be 8 because the image size is 512. I'm going to say 2. That would fit on my system. Learning rate equals to 1 in minus 4. Next is number of epoch. Let's train it for 20 epochs only, not more than that. Next is the model path and a CSV file path. Okay. So here is the path. Next, we would load the data set from the new data folder. If you see, if you remember, we have created this folder, the augmented data, and we have also properly resized the data set. So we're gonna just extract the data from these folders. So let's create a function for that also. And what we could call it, we're gonna call this function load data. Take the path. Next, we're gonna say x. Small x basically refers to image. Okay, x basically refer to image, y refer to mask, or you can say x refer to features, y refer to labels. So that sort of thing is there. So you're gonna say globe. Image, then all the images are in PNG format, so we're gonna say PNG, and same for the okay. We also need to provide another function, sort the list. If you remember, why do we need to use it? Just comment below, why do we need to use sorted function here? Here we're gonna say why. Okay, it should be why, not you. Now instead of image, we put right mask here. So we are going to return x comma y. Okay. Here we are. Now we're going to say, we're going to specify the dataset path first. Dataset path is equals to new data. Okay, it's okay. Then training path. Course.path.join. Dataset path. Then train. Okay, Next is the validation path, valid path. Valid path or test path basically the same. There's no separate split for the validation and testing here. You can create one for yourself. That's not an issue. But for this video, I'll use the same. Next, we're going to use our load data function to load the data set. So we're going to say train x, then train y. And then we're going to say load data, train path. Okay. Then valid x, valid y is to load data and then valid path. Okay. So now we're going to use our shuffling function to shuffle the training data, because it contains data augmentation. And if you arrange them in sorted order, then if we have two images in a batch, okay, then they would be same images of the same augmentation. That's why I will shuffle the data. So these two images would be entirely different images for a better generalization of the model. This is shuffling. Why did train x, train y? And why don't we shuffle the validation? We just want the validation to remain same so that we can check it. Okay, it's not an issue how validation is set. The main thing is the training. Like after the training is like when the because during training the model receive gradient, but during validation phase it does not receive any gradient. We just check the model. Now again we would check the length or the size of the data set. Okay. So let's run this file now. Yeah. Okay. So let's run this code. This file called train. Okay. So you can see we have 31,233 images for the training, but for validation we have zero. And that's why that. There need to be a particular region. Why it has loaded the data? Okay. This list is empty and this is not done. So data set path, new data. Let's print the path for the valid path. Let's check the path first. Okay, new data slash test. So let's go to the folder. Say new data slash test. Okay, I get it. Folder does not contain the data, and I know my mistake. What it is, I'll just show you now. Here, yeah, this is the mistake, and I've done it. So let me just run this program again, and we'll come again. Okay, so here, pause the video. So I've again run this whole process, and now we'll see if the new data contains something within the test folder. Okay, you can see now we have some data within the test folder. And like this really big mistake for me. I haven't just even taken care that the path is incorrect here. But still the work is done. Now let's again move to the train file and again run it. We'll see. Okay, you can see in validation we have 567 images. And in training, we have augmented the data and created nearly 31,000 images. Okay. So the data set loading part is complete. Now we'll start working on the pipeline, basically data input pipeline. So we'll create some simple functions first. First is the read image, which would take a path. Okay. With the path of image and given a numpy array. First of all, we're going to say path equals to path dot decode. This is done. We have decoded the string, that is this path. Next we will read the image using cv2 and we are going to read it as a RGB image. Now we're going to normalize its pixel by dividing it with 255. Now we are going to convert it into floor 32 specifically, that we know what is this data type.
Now we are going to return the x. We don't need to resize the data because we only have resized the data into a fixed 512 by 512 size. Next, again, same function, just that we're going to read the mask here. First of all, again, we're going to decode the path. Then copy these lines from over here. The image would be read as grayscale because the mask is in grayscale format and it contains pixels between 0 and 1. So we don't even need to normalize the mask pixels. They're already normalized. Again, we're going to convert it to float 32 and return it. Okay, one more thing. We need to expand the dimensions. And the last x. Okay, last x, not the first x. And we're going to return. Okay, spelling mistake is always there. Okay. Next, again, one more big function called tfparse. Okay. It take the x and y. X and y are the should be small x and y. The x and y is basically the path, okay, which would be given to these two functions respectively. So what we're gonna do, we're gonna again call a function inside it called parse. It again take the x and y. Here we will use our read image and read mask function. So we're gonna say x equals to read image x, y equals to read mask. Now we're going to return x comma y. Okay, if you see, we are using like numpy and the cv2 function basically. So these are things outside the TensorFlow environment, so we need to include these numpy functions and see OpenCV into the TensorFlow. So for that, there's a function called tf.numpy function. So functions basically which are outside the TensorFlow, to include any other function which is not present in the TensorFlow, you created it, build that function. So there is a special method. You cannot directly use this tfparse function or use this parse function. This parse, basically this parse function, which again use these read image and read mask function which is outside the TensorFlow. So we're going to call a function called tf.numpy array, numpy function of array. We first write the name of the function. Okay, this is underscore parse. Then we will give it the input which is taken by the parse function. Then we would provide the data type, specific data type written by the data. We're gonna say float 32 as we have specifically specified within the function, and we have converted these arrays into float 32. So now we can clearly write here that these are float 32 and it return two variable x and y. Now we need to set the shape for x and y. What are their shape? So we're going to say height, width and number of channel as 3, because we have read the it as RGB image and mask as grayscale. So it would be height, width and 1. Now we're going to return x and y. Next is the main function. We will call it tf dataset. It would take the path of images and masks. We call it capital X and capital Y and an optional badge of 2. So this is an optional argument. It has a default value of 2. You can choose the default value or you can change it accordingly. So we're going to say dataset equals to tf.data.dataset and from tensor slice. Okay, here we would write x and y. Okay, we provided a tuple of list. Next will be dataset equals to dataset dot map. So this tf function is basically used to read the path and convert it into array, then we'll array convert it into tensors and we'll set the shape. So we'll return a proper formatted images and mask in a proper form. So here we would use this tfparse function in the map. So what it does, it takes the individual path from this image and mask list and give it to this function x and y. Okay, and this function will read it and return it to the data set. So after we have start reading individual file, we'll create a batch of it. We're gonna say dataset equals to dataset dot batch. And we already have the batch size in the batch variable. Next, we're gonna say we're gonna prefetch some of the data set. Like while training, one batch is already in training. So it's going through the model calculating gradient. Till then, we can fetch the other batches into the memory so that it would not, the model would not have to wait to fetch the data. So we're gonna say prefetch. Let's specify 10 here. So we want 10 batches and each batch contain 2 images for now. And we're gonna return the data set. Okay, so this TF data set is now complete. Now we would create the data set. Train data set. TF data set. Train X. Train Y. And then a batch size, which is we have defined in the hyperparameters. Okay. Next, we're going to say valid data set. TF data set. Again, images valid X and valid Y. And again a batch size, then go copy from here. Okay, so we have done with this input pipeline. So I'm gonna say then y in train data set. Now I'm gonna print the shape. I'm gonna break it, okay, because it will run over and over again. We just want to see the shape of x and y. Okay, you can see batch of image and a batch of mask. Then you can see each batch contain 2 images. So if I would change this batch size from 2 to 8, so it would contain 8 images in batch. You can see 8 images. Size is fixed 512 by 512, number of channels 3. And in masks, again same size 512 by 512, but the mask number of channel, the mask is always 1. Okay, because it's a binary segmentation problem. So number of classes is basically 1, that is foreground class. Other is the background, which is always there even in multi-class and binary segmentation. Background class will always be included. And after background, there's only one class, that is foreground class in the binary. And in multi-class, there are more than one class. That's why it's called multi-class. Like I would upload a video on multi-class segmentation also in TensorFlow. Don't worry about it. Like in future, one or two video would be there. So for now, the dataset part is complete. Now we would work on the model. Okay, so we're going to say model equal to dplyr version 3 plus. Here we would give it input shape, height, width, and number of channel as 3. Okay, so we're going to say model.compile. First is the loss. And for loss, we're going to use dice loss. You can also use binary cross entropy, but dice loss is much better as compared to cross entropy in segmentation. So we need to specify some matrix here. So we can use 4 matrix for this program, and these are dice, IOU, recall, and precision. Now let's print the summary of this model to check whether it's running or not. Okay, so you can see the summary of the model and it's running successfully without any issue. Now we need to, now we'll use some callbacks which are used during training to save data, to monitor something. So you can see these are the list of all the callbacks. So there are 5 callbacks. Okay, first is the model checkpoint. This is basically used to save the weight file during training, because if we do not save the weight file, we don't have anything after the training. And we cannot every time train the model and then check it, train the model, check it. It would be really time consuming. It's like not a good idea. The next is a reduce LR on plateau. So this function is used to reduce the learning rate. Like if the learning rate, not the learning rate, the validation loss does not decrease, then it would decrease the learning rate with this specific factor. Next is CSV logger. It is used to decode all the matrices and loss function, every value for the training and validation while training in a CSV file. Next is TensorBoard. Log all the activity into TensorBoard for easy visualization. And the last is early stopping. Like if our validation loss does stops improving or stops decreasing for 20 continuous epoch, it would stop the training because it's unnecessary to train the model. Then wasting resources is not a good idea. So here is the last line, that is model.fit, the line which you all wait to work for. Now we'll run this model and start to train it. Okay, you can see the training and validation size, and here we have some messages from TensorFlow. Let's ignore them. You can see epoch 1 out of 20. And if you go to the folder, you can see files folder is created, logs is created. So files would, you can see the CSV file. So file would save the wait file and this CSV file. Logs is basically created by the TensorBoard. Okay, so you can see this some error there. If you see from the last, you can see this OOM. It's basically out of memory error. This means that we have set a really high batch size and model, the memory of the GPU is not able to cope up with that. So what do we need to do in that condition? In this condition, we need to set a batch size accordingly. As I've already told you that my GPU would not handle batch size more than 2 if the input size is 512 by 512. So now we'll wait if the training starts, or if we get an error, we will solve it. Okay, you can see the training begins, but you can see how much time it would take. So what we do, I'll stop the training because I've already trained this model a few epochs, and I will copy that wait file and that CSV file and show you the waits. So here's this file folder. I'm going to replace it. Can see we have data.csv file and the model.h5 file. So we can open this data.csv file. If you see, we have trained this model on 16 epoch and we have recorded everything, the dice, IUU, loss, learning rate, precision, recall, and same for the validation set also. So if you see the validation load is 0.4, 0.3, you can see it's really low. And you can see even on 16th epoch, the validation dice coefficient had reached 96. Okay, so this is the basically the training, but the scores are there while training, and we have the wait file. So we're going to use that wait file instead of training. But for on your side, you just, I want you to at least train on some few epochs. Even you can set the data augmentation off if you don't want to train on much higher data set, you don't have that GPU, but still train up to at least 2 epochs on your system and see what the performance is, because directly using my wait file would not be a solution. Okay, so now I want you to train the model and then we'll come back and evaluate the model. Now we will start working on the evaluation part of this video. Here we will use the validation or the test set and check its performance, okay, on the trained model. So we first start by importing all the required libraries. Okay. Next we'll import the rest of the code. And for the evaluation, I'm going to use the sklearn matrix, where I will calculate accuracy, F1, Jacquard, precision, and recall. Like we also have the score in this, the data.csv file, but still I want to build a separate file and calculate all the matrices using the sklearn. I will have some global parameters, that is height and width. I'm going to copy them from here. Okay, so we'll start with the main function first. Okay, so we can still copy some code from this train file, because even in the evaluation part, we need to seed the environment. Now here we'll create a folder called results, where we would save our mask, the predicted mask images and everything. Okay, so we have seeded the environment, we have created the directory to save the wait file. Now we'll load the model. Okay, we have the wait file saved in the files folder. Okay, so here we have loaded the model. Now we'll call the function model.summary. Eval. Okay, you can see the model summary is there. This means that the wait file has been successfully loaded into the model. Now we will load the data set. We will load the test set. Okay. Load data. So we need load data function. Okay, let's import the load data from train. Okay. And we're gonna copy some code from here. Okay, this part. Let me copy it. And we're gonna paste it here. So we need the validation path only. We do not need the training path. And we're gonna call the validation X and validation Y. Okay, there's some mistake here. Open this evaluation. Okay, so we have this validation. Now here we would call them test X. Okay. Because here they're working as the test set. So I'm going to change the name to test X and test Y from validation X to validation Y. Okay, so the data set is loaded. Let's print the shape. Okay, so let's check the length, the data. The size of the data, that is images and mask for the test set. You can see we have loaded the 567 images path and 567 mask path. Okay, now we'll start predicting, work on the prediction part and evaluation and prediction. We are going to calculate the matrices and save the prediction. So we are going to loop over the test X and test Y. So we're going to say X comma Y in zip test X test Y, and around the zip we're going to use TQDM, the progress bar. Okay, so first of all we are going to extract it same. If you remember this data.ppy file, we have done the same and we have extracted the name. If you remember this, so we would extract the name like this and copy this part here. We're going to say name x.split, and then we're going to split this x again. We're going to use my minus one, the last index, and ultimately we would get the name. I'm not going to explain this again, but I will break the loop here and again run it. You're gonna see the name. Okay, you can see the name has come, adult baby background bump. Now we'll read the image and mask. Reading the image. Okay, so we'll read the image. We'll say x equals to db2 dot. Okay, not x, we're gonna call it image. Okay, let me copy this code from the train file. We can copy this from train file. Next we're gonna we normalize it and then we convert it to float 32. We can even ignore this line here. We're gonna say image. Now we need to expand its dimension because we're gonna give image in a batch format, And here we have a single image. It's going to be batch of one image only. Span dimension on the axis one. So I'm going to show you shape before the expanding dimension, after expanding dimension. Okay, you can see the shape 512 by 512 by 3. And after expanding dimension, we have added a dimension in the first place at the 0th index, and it became 1 by 512 by 512 by 3. So it's basically list containing one image only. So batch of one image only. Okay, so we have successfully read the image. Now we would read the mask. Okay, so read the mask, we're gonna see mask equals to cv2 dot I am read y, and we are going to read it as a grayscale image, and we do not need to normalize it because it is ordinarily containing pixels between 0 and 1. So for mask we don't need to do anything, we just going to read it like this only. Now we need to make the prediction. Okay. We're going to say yPred model dot predict. We're going to give x as the input image, and we're going to say 0th index because there's only batch size of one image. So mask would also be batch size of one image only, and we're going to say 0th index. So we're going to extract the first item from this list. That's yPred. Now we're going to squeeze the yPred because its shape is like 512 by 512 by 1. So we're going to make it to 512 by 512. And axis is last dimension. Now we are going to convert it into. Now you're going to apply threshold to it. 0.5. So value greater than 0.5 would become 1 and rest remain 0. Now it would, we would convert it into integer 32 value. Okay, so we have predicted. Now we're going to save the mask first. Okay, compare it with the ground truth, how the things look. Let's give a path for the image, save image path, where this complete image need to be saved. Results is the folder which we have created at the beginning, if you remember this. And if you see the folder, the data folder, you have this results. I'll get back to the code and we'll have the path. Now we'll give it a name. And then an extension. Do we need an extension? Yes, we need an extension because we've extracted the image name only. We haven't extracted the extension, so we're going to say .png. Now we would create a function called save results, and here we would provide the original image, the mask, the ground truth mask. Now the prediction, predicted mask, and save image. Okay, and we would create this function. Here, after this creating directory, okay, we need to write def here. Okay, so what I'm gonna do, let me show you. First we would have this image, then after that image we would have the ground truth mask, then we have the predicted mask. Okay, that is vibrant. So in this sequence we're going to save the image, and after that I'm going to overlay the predicted mask on the image. Okay, so this is a sequence which we are going to save the image. So one thing we need to make sure that all of these images have same number of dimension. Okay, their height width would remain same, but the number of channels, like image have 3 channels, mask has 1, this has 1, and here we need to make sure that these also have 3 channels. So let me make sure that they have 3 channels, all of them. Okay, and between these images we need a separator, a line. Okay, so first of all we're going to create a line variable which is basically separated between two images. So we're going to say np.ones, we give it a height with h, 10 width and 3s number of channels, 128. So it's going to be a gray image. Now mask is equals to, now we're going to expand its dimension, the ground truth mask on the last axis, and then we're going to say mask equals to np.concatenate. So shape of mask has now become 512 by 512 by 1. So we are going to concatenate three masks, okay, on top of each other on the last axis. So now its shape would become 512 by 512 by 3. Okay, so now mask is done. We're going to do same with the prediction. We just need to change the name of the variable and we're going to replace them easily. Okay, so this is now done. The mask is done. The mask is done. The prediction is done. Now it's time for the multiplication of the original image with the predicted mask. Okay, before that, let me save these three images and show you how they look. Concatenate. Okay, here we write image, then a separator which is line, then we have the mask. Okay, then we have a line, and then we have the, what do you call it, vibrate on the axis one. Okay, so we have this complete image, we call it cat images. We're going to save it, cv2.imwrite, save image path. Okay, this is good. Then we have cat images. So we're going to run this program for one image only, and let's run it and see the result or there's any error. Okay, so it has run, I think. Running, okay, it has run completely for one iteration only. So in this results folder, okay, yeah, you can see we have three images, but these last two images are not visible. What we can do, we can multiply both these values with 255. If you remember, their pixels are in the range of 0 and 1, so we need to convert them to 255. Okay, it's again running for one iteration. Now we'll see how this image. Okay, so you can see first is the RGB input image, second is the ground truth mask, and third is the predicted mask. You can see how much similar the predicted mask is to ground truth. Now what we will do, we'll overlay this predicted mask over the original input image and see only the human image. Okay, and we will remove the background from it. So we're going to say mask image. Okay, we're going to give it this name, image into vibrate. Now what we'll do, we will remove this line from here. Now the pixel of vibrate are in 0 and 1. So what it will do, the area which is white, that is which has 1, would remain the same, and the pixel which is 0 would become black. After that we would write this line. And now we'll include this in the list on also. Let's run this again and see, one more image would be added to this list. So we have four total images. Now I can see we have four images. First is the input, then ground truth, then predicted mask, and then the masked image. So you can see the result is nearly good. It is very good, you can see. The model is trained on only 16 epoch with data augmentation, so the result is good. So now we have saved the mask. We can do that for all of the masks. Now next we will calculate the performance. Okay, so we're gonna create a score variable here. We're gonna call it score, capital score. Now what we need to do, we have saved the result Next, we need to calculate the matrix. For that, we need to flatten the array. Flatten the array. Okay. So we are going to flat the mask. Then we have this y print. Okay. So we have flattened this value. Now we are going to calculate these matrices. Okay. Calculating the matrix values. Okay, spelling mistake is there. So we are going to calculate the accuracy. So we're going to say accuracy score. Then we're going to give it the ground truth value, then the predicted value. Okay, the mask and the vibrant. Next is F1 value. We're going to say F1 score. Then we're going to give it the mask and the vibrant. Next, we have some called labels and average equals to binary. Okay. So in labels, there are only two labels, 0 and 1. 0 refers to the background, 1 refers to the foreground. So two main classes. So like this, we're going to calculate the rest of the values. What I'm just going to do, I'm going to copy this. Next is the Jacquard value. Jacquard score. Okay, should be Jacquard. After Jacquard, it's recall. We're gonna say recall score. That is the function. Okay, it's 10. Next, the precision value. Precision value. Next function name is precision score. Okay, so we have all the scores or the values or the matrix values. So we are going to append them in the score variable. So the score would contain the name of the image, the accuracy, F1, Jacquard, recall and precision. Okay, just imagine we do it for all values. Now the score would contain all the individual values. Now what we're gonna do, we're gonna calculate the score, calculate the mean score. Okay, so here we calculate the mean score, the mean accuracy, F1, Jacquard's and recall and precision, everything. And next, at last, we are going to save the result of the individual files in a pandas. Using the pandas, we're going to save them in a CSV file. So like this is all about scores. Now again, we're going to run it on one iteration only and see if for one iteration it can give us good result. Means give some result, not good. Okay, so this is for one iteration, or this means it's only for one image. So it's the result for first image. You can see for first image we have this score. Now we can run this on a total of 567 images. So let's do that and run it for 567 images by removing this break statement. Let's wait. So we have to wait now because it would take some time. You can see it's running. Now if we go to the this results, you can see these images, and that result I feel is really good. It's not that bad. You can see here, this is natural background. It's not like white or any plain background, but still out of focus. You can see that the results are really good. But here you can see it has also segmented the ball here in the ground truth. It is not that ball is not considered here, but here in the predicted mask, the mask, the ball is there. I don't know what ball is it. Is a ball? If you know what do we call this ball, please comment below for that. Like we can see the result are really good here. Like there's some little confusion with this extra part, this extra segmentation. So what we need to do, we need to train it more and use much better architecture to get better result. Like in future I will like try to improve it further and get better results. Okay, you can see it would still take 2 minutes and 30, no, 2 minutes, 2.5 minutes it would take. So let me just wait and pause the video here. Okay, so this process is finished and we have our score. So accuracy is 97%, F1 is 95, Jacquard 92,
recall 95 and precision also 95. So you can see that result is really good. It's really, really good, if I say. Now you can see we have these predictions and we can just see them. So you can see this image, like we have opened, is really well segmented. Like you can see. And the mask image is like really good. We can see only little detail. I think this is extra detail. I think it's a hair. Yeah, I think it's the hair. Yeah, you can see. So you can see the model is performing really well. Even we just need to little fine tune it more to get much more better performance. Okay. So these are the predictions, if you say, on the validation or test set. Now how about prediction on the unknown image? Let's pick up images on the internet and we're gonna make predictions on them. So let's do that now. So we're gonna create a new file and we're gonna call it predict. Okay, let's, before that, here you can see we have this course. Now we have the CSV file also. I just forgotten the CSV file. Okay, let's see this CSV file also. You can see this CSV file which contain the score of the individual images. So these are the images. These are 257 images. You can see, not 257, 567. I think. Yeah, 567. You can see for each individual image you have the score. Like this image, we have really bad score. I think. Yeah. I don't know. Something happened. Must have happened here. There must be some issue. So like this, we can see the individual image. And which image perform much better, which perform really bad. Like this image perform like really well. It has 99 accuracy, 99 f1 and 98 jaguar. So I think it performed really well. And there's also other case 99 and 99. So like this, from this score CSV file, you can analyze the score of individual and you can see which image has much problem and which has less problem. So it would help you better analyze your model results, how capable your model is. Okay. And which images cause the problem. So which images you need to focus more, which data you need more. Now we'll start work on another file where we would take the images from internet. Okay. And then we would make predictions on them. So first of all, we need a data set. Okay. So we will download images from internet. Let me open my browser. The website wallpaper cave. We will download some wallpaper from this website. We're gonna say people. We need images of people. Okay, you can see. Okay, pretty people. We have 28 wallpaper for these pretty people advertisement. Okay, you can see we have these images. These are images of celebrities, I think. Of people. Okay, so we're gonna download these images. So to download, I have this add-on called Patkun download batch images. So I'm gonna download all these images. Okay, so it would grab all these images, okay, from this website. So I don't want to download this image. Okay, so we're gonna download these images. You can see these are downloading. Okay, so these all are downloading. So you can see we have these images, so I'm gonna cut them. And we're going to create a separate folder here and we're going to call them test images. And inside test images, we have one folder called image and we're going to save them here. So let me just show you. So these are really high resolution images and some images are landscape, some are portrait, some are like grayscale format. You can see this image is literally grayscale. So that's why I've included grayscale in the data augmentation. You can see again a grayscale image, then a portrait. So different kind of images is there with different background. So we're going to take these images and make prediction upon them and see how the results look. So let's create a new file called predict. So now let's start working on that. So we can, like, we need some code from this evaluation file. Okay, we don't need the data, we don't need this. Okay, we're gonna need this. I'm gonna import it. Like, we don't need this line, so I'm gonna delete it from train import.
create dir. Okay, let me again just copy some code. This global features, not global feature, the global parameters. Next, we're going to load the model. So we're going to copy it till loading the model, because we surely need the model, the train model. Okay, now we need to load the data set. Okay, so now we're going to load all these images which we have downloaded, all these images which are in the test images and then image folder. So we're going to say data x equals to globe, and the path is test images slash image slash star. So I want to extract all the images from that. Okay, so before that, we're going to create a directory and we're going to call it test images slash mask. So we don't want the results directory, which is already created. We would save this mask, the predicted mask, in this test images and with a mask folder inside it. Okay, so we are going to loop over this. So we're going to say for path in pqdm data x and total equals to length of data x. Okay, now loop is ready. We're going to loop over it. So now we're going to extract its name. If you remember the way how to extract the name, now we're going to read the image. I'm going to say image equals to cv2.imread path and cv2.imread color. Okay, so now if you see, these images are not in original, like 512 by 512 size, they are different size. So what I want is the mask should be in original size only. I don't want to resize the image like what we have done here in this results, where all the images are resized to 512 by 512. So I don't want that. I want to make the mask of the same size as the image. So we're going to calculate its, find its height and width and save them in capital small h and small w. So small h, small w refer to the height and width of the image, not the global. Now we're going to resize this image. Width by height. Okay. And now we are going to normalize its pixel by dividing them with 255. Okay. So we have the image ready. Now we're going to make prediction. So what we're going to do, we're going to say y. So y refer to the prediction. Model dot predict x is the image and 0 index number. Now we're going to resize it. Okay, so the size of the mask here is 512 by 512, so we're going to resize it to the original image size, that is, these are the given height and width. So we're going to say y equals to cv2.resize y and width by height. So make sure that you write these small h and w, not these capital ones, so don't confuse them with these capital H and capital W, with small h and small w. These are different. Now we are going to expand its dimension on the last axis. So now we have this mask, okay, the prediction mask as the shape of the original image. Now what we're going to do, we are going to create a masked image like what we have done in the evaluation, I'll evaluation. So image into y, like here you can see we haven't applied any threshold value, so I'm going to try it before threshold value. Let's say save image, saving the image. So now we're going to first create a line sep. So line basically means a separator between the original image and the masked image. It's going to be np dot ones, and it should be small h, then 10 pixel wide width and 3 into 128. Okay. Now we have cat images. np dot concatenate. And there's a list of image, then a line, and then masked image on the axis one. Okay. Now we're gonna save it. The path is test images slash mask, then the name, and then png, the extension, and we're going to say cat images. Okay, this program is really simple. It is done. Now we'll see prediction or the prediction of the masked images without any threshold applied. So now the value of this y is between 0 and 1. They are not 0 and 1, they are between 0 and 1. So we're going to run it. Prediction. Okay, so I think these are 28 images. Yeah, these are 27 images. Okay. Let's, okay, you can see it's processing. So it would take a little amount of time because the images are really high resolution, and then first downsampling and then upsampling them would take little amount of time. Okay, so we go into the mask folder. Okay. If I see these images, you can see the original image and the masked image. So you can see it, the model perform really well, but the hair issue is with the hairs, because hair are like little really fine details, and the model isn't it like working finely on it, because it need more data with this for these fine details. Let's see more images. Okay, here you can see the hair are not an issue here, so it has successfully removed the background from this image. Same for this image. We can see the model is okay. You can see some over segmentation is there. Now it worked for this image also. So see these, all these images, we can say it has worked fine. These images, the result is fine. It's not that good, and it's good, but it's not that bad. Like somewhere the little extra ones over segmentation is there, but I think the data set is not like that fine. Okay, if you see original data set, it's not that fine. You can see that result is well. It's working really well. Yeah, we have reached the original. So you can even see that the model performed really well on the images which we have taken from the internet. Now the model does not know anything about these images. You can see the validation or test set at least use in the validation. Okay, the model knows for which epoch we have to save the file, or at least it knows. But for these images, model does not even see them. You can download more images and see how the model perform. Okay, we can see what we have learned in this entire video is that how do we start with segmentation problem, how do we do data processing, we augment the data. Okay, then we, how do we build this deep learning version 3+ model, then we have added channel wise attention mechanism, that is squeeze and excitation network. Okay, then we have trained the model, then we evaluate the model, and now we are predicting on the images which are available on the internet. Okay, so I hope I was able to give you some new information for this video, and if you enjoyed it, then please subscribe the channel, like this video, and share it with your friends so that they can also get this knowledge. And if you are really enjoying the content, do check out the membership. Okay, if you take the membership, you will support my channel, and in return you will get more content like this, and you also help me in my research. Okay, thank you, have a nice day.